Tupolev Tu-160 White Swan, or Blackjack, was entirely a product of Cold War paranoia. First flown in 1981, the aircraft quickly became one of Russia's most effective aircraft ever produced. Because of its impressive and state-of-the-art configuration, the colossal variable sweep-wing heavy strategic bomber and missile platform remains the fastest, largest, and heaviest Mach 2 aircraft ever produced, alongside the American XB70 Valkyrie. In addition, it has such a massive airframe that it can store over 45,000 kilograms worth of ordnance. Over 30 Tu-160s have been produced throughout the decades, with some of them receiving significant modifications to specialize in different roles. Still, Russia recently embarked on a new project to modernize the program and revamp the aircraft, hoping to take the Blackjacks into the future by making them even more powerful and lethal. Mutual Assured Destruction. As part of the arms race and the military doctrine of Mutually Assured Destruction, or MAD, the United States and the Soviet Union embarked on developing all sorts of atomic weapons and offensive systems that could use these new and merciless devices. The threat of a preemptive nuclear strike was all too palpable for either side to wait and do nothing. And even as they sat down and discussed a limitation treaty, it did not work out as intended. The MAD term, coined by military strategist Donald Brennan, stuck in the early 1960s. From then on, it was used to refer to the rising nuclear rivalry between NATO and the countries involved in the Warsaw Pact. The first use of atomic weapons to destroy the cities of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in Japan was airborne. The first bomb, Little Boy, weighed around 4,400 kilograms and carried over 15 kilotons of TNT, and was dropped on top of Hiroshima by the B-29 bomber Enola Gay. The second bomb, Fat Man, weighed 4,670 kilograms and carried 21 kilotons of TNT. It was also dropped by a Boeing B-29, the boxcar. At the time, this was the only way of delivering nuclear ordnance to destroy an enemy location. However, the rapid development of new technologies allowed the power of the atom to adopt a new form that left behind the cumbersome World War II-era bomb, the Intercontinental Ballistic Missile, or ICBM. Although other weapon systems would be eventually developed to fire some sort of nuclear device, the ICBM proved the most lethal and effective innovation ever produced in the history of modern warfare. Valkyrie. Despite the ICBM's supremacy, the Americans soon started developing a nuclear-capable, supersonic strategic bomber, the XB-70 Valkyrie. Not wanting to stay behind, the Soviets immediately used every undercover spy in the US and the West to find out more about the type of aircraft that the Americans were striving for. The XB-70 Valkyrie was the prototype version of the intended B-70 nuclear-armed deep-penetration supersonic bomber of the US Air Force. Since the early 1950s, the Air Force and the Pentagon had begun research on a bomber aircraft that could deliver nuclear weapons into the Soviet Union directly from the United States. This aircraft had to carry enough fuel to allow for the complete journey to the USSR to deliver the payload, and for the way back to the United States. Additionally, this large bomber needed to achieve supersonic speeds to escape the nuclear blast radius and interception from hostile enemy fighters. The XB-70 Valkyrie went through different iterations and variants to fulfill all its objectives, and even though the two prototypes that were built were destined for supersonic test flights, the project was ultimately ditched in the 1960s with the development of surface-to-air missiles. The White Swan rises. Despite the cancellation of the American Valkyrie bomber, the Soviets carried on with their own copycat project, which would eventually become something entirely new. In 1967, the top brass of the Soviet Air Forces launched a competition to create an aircraft to outmatch the Valkyrie and the B-1 bomber project. The requirements called for developing a supersonic swing-wing heavy bomber with an expected speed of Mach 2.3. The Tupolev Design Bureau's 160M design was selected after it was matched against the Sukhoi T-4 and the Myasishchev M-18. It incorporated some features of the Tu-144 bomber and advanced technologies not previously used on Soviet bombers. By 1972, its development was already in half progress. The Tu-160 earned its White Swan nickname after its anti-flash white airframe coating. The aircraft's wing and fuselage were gradually integrated into a single-piece configuration, and the White Swan features an all-titanium structure that gives it a tight and firm appearance in addition to its unique white coating. Its variable geometry wings sweep back from 20 to 65 degrees to enhance the aircraft's subsonic and supersonic speeds. As for the tail surfaces, they are horizontal and vertical and all moving. The aircraft's massive wingspan is 55.7 meters. Overall, it has a length of 54.1 meters, a height of 13.1 meters, an empty weight of 110,000 kilograms, and a maximum takeoff weight of 275,000 kilograms. In addition, its two internal bomb bays have a capacity for up to 45,000 kilograms of payload, and two internal rotary launchers have 12 AS-16 kickback short-range nuclear missiles and six Reduga KH-55SM cruise missiles. The AS-16 short-range missiles have a range of 300 kilometers and usually carry a warhead of over 150 kilograms with a blast yield of around 300 kilotons. Meanwhile, the KH-55SM missile has a maximum range of 3,000 kilometers and is armed with a 200 kiloton nuclear warhead. The colossal and heavy White Swan is powered by four Samara NK-321 afterburning turbofan engines that allow the bomber to reach a maximum speed of Mach 2.05, or about 2,500 kilometers per hour. Without in-flight refueling, the White Swan can achieve a range of 12,300 kilometers, while its combat range is estimated at 2,000 kilometers at speeds of Mach 1.5. Also, its rate of climb is 70 meters per second. All of the Swan's avionics are computerized, and it features integrated flight control, navigation, aiming electronic countermeasure systems, and an attack radar. In addition, the aircraft is manned by a crew of four, including a pilot, co-pilot, operator, and navigator. Each crewman has 0-0 ejection seats that allow them to eject safely if necessary. Combined with its combat payload and range, the Tu-160 decisively fulfilled its goal of getting close enough to the continental United States and releasing its arsenal of devastating nuclear missiles. Its first flight occurred in December of 1981, and it entered service with the Soviet and Ukrainian Air Forces in 1987. When the Soviet Union collapsed in 1991, 19 of the 36 produced White Swans were part of the 184th Guards Heavy Bomber Aviation Regiment, located at Perluki Air Base in Ukraine. With Ukraine's independence, the aircraft became part of the newly established Ukrainian Air Force, which led to tensions between both countries during the Kosovo War in 1999. The Kremlin then tried to purchase its Tu-160 fleet back from the Ukrainian government, but it was to no avail. After years of discussions, Russia finally purchased the fleet back, along with over 570 cruise missiles. The negotiation resulted in the cancellation of a $285 million gas debt that Ukraine owed to Russia. The new Tu-160M. After it got its entire White Swan fleet back, Moscow strove to rebuild and revamp it for 21st century warfare, and in 2006, the first upgraded Tu-160 was delivered. This version, modified by Kazan Aircraft Production Organization, featured upgraded targeting systems and an electronic warfare suite. In September of 2008, a pair of White Swans made the first transatlantic flight of its type, achieving a world record. The aircraft even reached Venezuela, where President Hugo Chavez greeted its crew and told the press, quote, "Russian strategic bombers, Tu-160s, have landed in Venezuela. Yes, yes. So that way, it hurts Yankees." 2 years later, another pair of White Swans broke a world record when they completed a 23-hour patrol that covered over 18,000 kilometers of flight range. After that, the Tu-160s have received several upgrades from other Russian companies. The Blackjacks, as they were nicknamed by NATO, were combat tested for the first time in 2015 and 2016 when they launched KH-101 missiles to anti-Assad insurgents in Syria. After such decisive combat actions, Russian Minister of Defense Sergei Shoigu announced that they would relaunch the Tu-160M. Then, in January of 2018, President Vladimir Putin ordered 10 of these new aircraft. The $270 million Tu-160M took to the skies for the first time on January 12, 2022, at the factory airfield of the Kazan Aviation Plant. And although minor details about this relaunched variant are known, leaked documents indicate that it features a state-of-the-art mission system and avionics, including a cockpit with digital displays, an NV-70M radar, and a brand new reconnaissance system. During a press conference, United Aircraft Corporation director Yuri Slyuzar stated that, quote, "Tu-160 is one of the largest and most high-tech projects in the aviation industry. The implementation of this program required not only the renovation of production facilities, but also the creation of a fundamentally new digital environment for working on the project. The fundamental importance of today's event is that the new machine has been completely rebuilt from scratch. The systems and equipment in the new machine have been updated and modernized by 80%. The Minister of Defense has also announced that it plans to have the Tu-160Ms in service until the late 2050s, positing the formidable aircraft for a long and prosperous career. Thank you for watching our video. Please like and subscribe to our Dark Documentaries channels to find more exciting historical content. And let us know in the comments below what you think of the Tu-160 Blackjack. Also, don't forget to click on the bell icon to be notified of our newest content. Stay tuned.